About the content of this presentation is that you will have the slide at the end, no problem with that. But I always start by making an introduction about the context of the specific actions Ella has introduced just before. Just for you to be able to reuse the right wording concerning the different actions. So you will see. So the agenda in detail regarding the content of the presentation is, okay, a short introduction about the overall business about hubs or similar. I will present the different initiatives. I will make a focus mainly today on the last one, so the Open Innovation Testbed. And you will have to wait up to the end to have an idea about the content of a document that will be circulating quite soon, end of October, was the plan to distribute the document, which is a FAQ regarding the different questions and the answers about what is Open Innovation Testbed. So after, we will open a 15-minute session of questions and answers, if I can. So for some slides, I will go I will be brief, just because I think you, as an NCP, you know all the context, I am sure, more than me. But you have the story that allowed to have at the end the presentation of the networking activities developed. Let's start. First of all, it's yes to the present, but it's my interpretation of the global story. So take care about this content. It's not an official position of the European Commission, even if I reuse all their slides, more or less 59%. And everything, as always, is more complex than what I can summarize today, and this will be more and more the case. The scene. Everybody is speaking about impact, networking, sharing of expertise, best practices on technologies and transfer of knowledge. This challenge is today the one for all the DGs, and we can see that they are starting to synchronize their view in terms of action. For sure, there is no one single entry point for all the action, regarding all the action for one actor. But we see that they are discussing each week about the actions, the synchronization regarding the community. Perhaps for FP9, we will have some novelty that will solve a lot of and improve the service for the community. So I will speak about modernization, ecosystems, smart specialization, platforms, online platforms, and the way to transfer from research to market. One common point for these strategies is that they relate to key enabling technologies. The goal is really to improve the impact, the quality of the impact for the different actors. Actors being an industrial, an SME, mid-tech, mid-cap, any type of participant that would like to get in innovation and to, at the end, make business for this innovation. The goal is also to improve the service, the quality of the service regarding the actor, and also to encourage the cooperation between the actors, the regions, and also the member states and the European Commission. So you see that it's more and more complex in terms of overall picture, but the objective is for them to justify, if I can say, the impact, the benefits for the society of the research project. Yes, just for who knows already me, sometimes I make shortcut image, caricatural image, so take into consideration this point when I present some elements. Regarding how to offer a single upstream point at the end, in a few years, I hope, they are identifying where are the infrastructures, what is their purpose, what they can offer in terms of service, in terms of capabilities. And we see from different point of view, from different digits, a set of cartographies, maps, that represent either a technical center, like the one you see on the left with DigiGrow, the map of pilot lines, the previous project funded by DigiRTD, the I4MS Innovation Hub and Competence Centers, I will present just after, and also something relatively new, the catalog of Innovation Hub initialized by DigiConnect and managed by one consortium led by TNO and now the GRC. So you see a lot of points, and now the problem is how to organize the access and the collaboration of this ocean of infrastructure. I will present the different initiatives. Looking to DigiGrow, so I will go fast on this point. DigiGrow is to improve the leadership and increase the market share of the different actors across Europe, to justify also investment in infrastructures. So this is their objective. What they try to organize. I have a question. What? Sorry for this interruption, because we have a specific game for you after. Yes, so sorry. DigiGrow has different targets. The regions are one of the targets. Finding a way to increase the participation of actors from industry, from the community, and also to identify where are the key actors across Europe for the domains. It's related to smart specialization. So they have developed a concept, a platform, industrial modernization platform, and they plan to offer, through their coordination, a set of services in order to help the market to grow, the actors to benefit from the different innovations. And their focus is driven by key enabling technologies. And for sure, digital transformation is a key point now for any business. But the services that go with the transfer of technology is also in their concern, this key point. So they have developed, specifically regarding our concern today, a mapping of the technology infrastructures. And it's a survey they have organized. It's an auto-evaluation of the actors and their capabilities to transfer technology and knowledge. So there is a result today from this survey. More than 200 infrastructures identified across Europe. 60% of them are in key countries, if I can say. And they offer the services about validation, demonstration, the POC, certification and validation of product and pilot line also. This is the first result where they are today. And in order to improve the collaboration among the different actors of this very large community, they introduced a call in 2017 about a new sub call about manufacturing, and the goal is really to encourage and to facilitate the exchange, the networking between the different actors. And there is already a proposal selected. It's a Kate for Clean Production that is the winner of this action today. So I think now we have a specific game, if I can say. I don't know how to manage at this point. I have to remove my presentation just for you. Ella, if you can introduce the game.
Yes, okay, so we have a quiz to see if you've been listening so far. So the question is, in the poll, have you been involved in the identification of the KET technology infrastructure? And so please answer this poll, and I will broadcast the results. You still have a few seconds to answer. Okay. Thank you. So it's more or less spread out. 50% of you have and 50% of you haven't. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, so now we can introduce a second initiative. I would say at the moment the biggest one in terms of impact visibility. It's the one from DigiConnect. Again, official slide from the Commission. This one is mine, in fact. just to have where this is coming from. In fact, they started through this initiative, I4MS, to see a lot of actors coming together through proposals, and DigiConnect identified that, okay, this could be this type of joint collaboration in a project between actors. They could represent innovation hub or competence center, and perhaps through this project we could encourage the networking between all these across Europe between the project selected through I4MS and also all the clients of this project. And so as an introduction, I4MS is related to four domains: CPS, IoT, robotics, HPC, and design, modeling, simulation. Only related to manufacturing systems. This is the situation today. So you see a lot of competence centers, more and more, because with the phase three today, we will have new competence centers and innovation hubs. And faced to this situation, the Commission starting to think, okay, but perhaps we have to refine, to organize a little bit how this infrastructure can network for the benefit of the different actors, because now they network only through the project and using cascade funding or the open call they organize. But there is something better to be done. And at this point, yes, I have forgot also a similar initiative to I4MS, which is a Smart Anything Everywhere, that is more dealing with, oh, sorry, I have to switch. Yes, you don't see it. Smart Anything Everywhere, that is dealing with cyber physical systems, embedded processing systems, advanced microelectronics, and so on. So two main initiatives in the domain of the ICT, I4MS, and Smart Anything Everywhere. And there are calls for these topics, these points. And after two runs of I4MS call, Commissioner Oettinger put in place the strategy digitizing European industry, digital single market, and DigiConnect was recognized as a leader for managing the interaction between all the actors, because now we have also member states through the national initiative that can take part of the dialogue in this context. So you see the complexity, you can imagine how this is difficult to have a clear view on that. But it's important. Why this is important for all the actors that will make proposal? That they have to refer, like with the traceability, to all the points that are mentioned today by DigiConnect. Because they have to show that they will participate to satisfy the requirements of the call you see in the iFarmers part, that they are linked with the action digitizing European industry, about ecosystem, platform, networking, addressing impact like regulatory framework, safety, validation, certification, and also transferring knowledge, technology, and organizing the transfer in collaboration with universities and so on. So the situation is more and more complex when you have to propose to answer to a topic for this innovation hub of DigiConnect. There is an overall scene with the place of Smart Anything Everywhere and i4MS. So they have organized their actions. It's also important to know what is the interfaces we have to consider. Like I said, it's always a traceability when we have to deliver a proposal. And in addition, now, this was another complexity introduced from the pop-up of Industry 4.0 for the other initiatives at national level. So now there is also this type of initiatives that are on the market, that present infrastructures, that present customers, clients, that we have somewhere to consolidate or to integrate in any proposal. This is a recommendation. We cannot fly alone somewhere. We have to show that we'll participate to this wave of actions. And we are, thanks to Europe, able to organize a better dissemination of the technologies and knowledge. So for NCP, you have to encourage your actors to be closed to these different actions. Now, regarding the digital innovation hubs, the Commission, so you will see just after, is organizing a survey, but the philosophy for them is, okay, the Commission is only able and they will only encourage, help to set up networks. They will force through the call to have cross-border experiments. It's typically for the EU13, if I can make it short. And they will establish a catalog that anybody in Europe can access to this list and find the right, I would say, technology provider. For the member states, their role is to really set up at national and regional level the structure to fund, to be clear, this infrastructure, because sustainability is now a key point when we have to discuss about networking. We cannot anymore think that, okay, the project has a duration of 4 years, and after we start from zero for the next step. Commission is encouraging clustering of projects. And we have seen that from some projects, they review through the consortium agreement the collaboration, synchronization between several projects, and they force the leader to really have actions of clustering, networking, just to identify the synergies and develop, I would say, a common common vision on the actions. So what is a digital innovation hub? It's something related to digital transformation, for sure. Hub is characterized mainly by its ability to address an ecosystem, so relevant ecosystem regarding the technologies. You can see already the link with the smart specialization strategy. If one lab is somewhere the middle of nowhere, no chance for it to be heard at the end, it's clear. So he has to present, when he submits a proposal, evidences that he will be able to manage, organize this ecosystem. It's key. And you see on the left the different services, different elements that characterize a hub. So mentoring, training, coaching, pilot, fab lab, pre-production of system, investor readiness services. So you see it's really more business-oriented approach, including technologies for sure, but also including the support services, what I call support services, like technology foresight, mentoring, brokerage, and so on. This is a key characteristic today for the digital innovation hubs. You see here the difference between a digital innovation hub and a competence center. Competence center is, I would say, only, a platform, infrastructure, where we can develop research, make a first proof of concept, develop best practices, demonstrate something. But for Innovation Hub, the services, like I mentioned before, are really the differentiation. And now it's clear where is the difference. This is an official slide from the Commission. Regarding the Digital Innovation Hub, so there is today a map developed by the GRC today. This is a result of a project managed by TNO today, and they have launched a consultation through web, through consultation to the member states about the infrastructures that could be recognized or that could be tomorrow innovation hub. So we will see an assessment of the maturity for the infrastructures. And there is already, if you follow the link, a map that represents the different candidates for innovation hub. I just want to say for the French actors that we have a conflict with this team today because the cartography doesn't represent the situation we have provided to them. So we have an action to solve this problem. So you can see that at the end, we have to take care when we make a cartography. At the origin, Max Lemke and others plan to have only 150 infrastructures to be labeled somewhere innovation hubs, and now they are close to 600. So what can we do, what can they do with this sea of hubs? It's a new problem, and the answer is please member states and regions manage this problem. Regarding the call dealing with hubs for the next port program, there are several calls, two for the first wave, so 2018-19, one for robotic, about 64 million euros, and the other for smart anything everywhere, with 48. And really the volume will be more for the last phase, 2020. I think they are waiting for the definition of a strategy to be applied from the consultation, from the notification of hubs through the survey they've launched. Don't forget, there is also hubs dealing with agriculture today in the call. I think they will publish also calls in the future about health and perhaps smart cities. So there is an evolution to network, to organize networks between all the different sectors. The characterization of hub is to be first really embedded in the strategy of its region. It's clear. Just for to be able to present the ability to address a relevant ecosystem. Also to have, I would say, to present some evidences that we'll receive with money or not the support from the regions. So this point, this first bullet is very, very important. After, to be able to develop offer through the open calls, they will develop year after year a set of critical mass of experimentations, including cross-border experimentations. So there are already requirements related to the part associated to the different actors. And now they have to present evidences about sustainability after the end of the project. So it's not one network during the life of one project. It's really a network with a long-term sustainability, taking benefit of the funding at national and also regional level. I can imagine that it's sometimes difficult to have a guarantee about the support of either member states of regions, but more they present guarantee, more they have a chance to get funding funded at the end. One point that appears during the second third phase, if I'm right, of I4MS is the development of cross-border application experiments. Just to avoid to address only the SMEs in the bigger states, to be short, but really to address ES14, this is a specific objective. So the project shall present already some satellites in other countries. Not only in France, Germany, if I can take a more bad example, but with Slovenia, Estonia, and so on as another example. This is the goal of the project, to really be sure that they will address all Europe. I think it's important to have the view about the different calls. The projects are the open call they plan to have. So you have different projects in I4MS or in Smart Anything Everywhere. And you have already the planning of the different open calls they offer. At the moment, two calls on robotic are running with the project Horse and Reconcile. And you have website where you can find information about the different calls and the characteristics. In addition, as I said, we have to think about co-funding, additional funding, in addition to H-Rate 2020. So any type of funding accessible through region, through smart specialization, is also to be considered in the proposal. Obviously, private funding, loans, is also an advantage for that. As a rationale, in the identification in the setup of Digital Innovation Hub. This is the process that is proposed. So, as I said, just to be sure that you can highlight your ability to address an ecosystem, to get interest from companies regarding what you offer, quality of your, what you offer in terms of services, in terms of tool, in terms of platform, and your ability also to capitalize and exchange at European level. So, as a conclusion, this is really important, this first point, the regional and national funding. This is a guarantee that this will be sustainable after the end of the project. It's a key criteria. Second bullet is now obvious, the work program is published. Please have a look with the link to Futurium to the Digitizing European Industry working groups, one or two. They are developing with the voice of member states what is now the purpose of the national initiative, which type of action they can put in place at national level in order to support the dissemination of technologies across Europe. I think we have a specific test for you.
Okay, time for a quiz. Let me set that up, this up, see if you guys are still listening by now. So, are ICT calls in your portfolio of activities? That was the question. I will leave you a few seconds to answer. So, are you concerned as NCPs by the ICT calls? Okay, so for those of you who are still listening and awake, I can see that 60% of you are concerned with ICT calls, whereas 40% of you are not. So, thank you. I think we have another poll prepared. Let me set this up. So, poll number 5. So, this is more a test to see if you have been carefully listening to DJs. So do you think private structures can be part of a digital innovation hub? Okay, there seems to be a bit of shyness. Oh. Well, that looks like a unanimous answer with 100% of you guys saying yes. Thank you.
Just before to resume the presentation, I see Moritz has difficulties to hear me, but I am really close to the headset, so I don't know to increase a specific email for me. Hey Moritz, I cannot satisfy your request. Let's continue now with the most interesting part. Regarding considering the timing, I think you have all seen the first slide, so I will go really fast. So we see now for the DRTD that they are looking to develop a set of test bed about upscaling, about characterization, about modeling. And with the same objective is to create an European ecosystem. Several topics, I'm sure you know more than me. I don't have provided a breakdown in terms of budget, but for example, for an MPP 1 and 2, it's 65 million euros. for both. Important point, the calls today are open, are two steps call, very important also to mention. And the timing for this set of calls is over the three years. This you know, so don't forget that for any proposer, they have to present evidences regarding what they can really deliver, what is the sustainability, what is their sustainability also, how they will help to develop, to have an impact on the market. So for their hub or test bed, they have to present a business case, an exploitation strategy regarding industrialization. And they have to set up, when it doesn't exist at the right level of quality, the relevant infrastructure and mainly the services. Commonality between DG Connect and DG RTD is okay. It's obvious that they have to present an infrastructure, innovation infrastructure, but they have to offer services. It's key. Have an example. For example, you have here the project proposal shall or can address several sectors, dealing with several technologies, with several capabilities like pilot, characterization, modeling, and the consortium will be, for example, based on several locations or several individual actors, and they have to share among them the activities. For example, one actor can be specialized in pilot, the other in characterization, the other in modeling, and they will offer through a single entry point the access to any technology, service, any expertise. It's very important. As a view, you remember that they have developed at the level of DGRTD pilot lines. They have put in place a council for modeling, characterization, some actions regarding organic safety with a cluster, with some projects. But now, and this would be valid also for FP9, they want to have really networks at the end, sustainable networks, it's clear. So what is the scope of a testbed? So it's open access to facility services, demonstration with TRL level 7, it's important. It's a showcase through cross-border applications. The target is really the SMEs. But not only for one application, we have to provide transfer all along the value chain of a sector. So you offer through their consortium a value chain of technologies and services, and they have to address the same the value chain for a sector, the same, just to have a better impact, coordination of actions, better potential. This one is a repetition of the previous one, trying to summarize, but really to offer all the chain of facilities, of capabilities, and for Nano today, their main concern is about regulation and standardization. It's really important. impact is to have networks through the proposals at European level. They will offer specific, I would say, services, or they will offer services with the right value of the cost. It's not a commercial company directly. They will have to show that they will transfer innovation for a specific domain. And they will offer also, they will offer services for SMEs. Now something that is new, more or less new, but new in this version. We have developed during the co-construction of the work program 18-20 with the Commission the set of frequently asked questions in order to define and share what is really innovation testbed. What I have, what I will present today, it's the version of the questions and answers that I have received in September. They will publish end of this month the final version. So take care, read the last version just to be sure that there is no major change and so on. This is a more interesting part of the presentation, if I can say, depending of where we start, where you start. And this shall help all the proposers. It's clear. It's a set of answers that cannot be part of the work program as it is defined today, because it's too specific. Some terms could introduce, I would say, doubt or trouble, or have introduced fight regarding what is the objective of the Commission, what they can do, and the actors, and so it's really a different document that is here to help. But this will be transferred to the evaluators. It's really important. So what they are? So it's physical facilities, demonstrating, testing, upscaling on the domain of nano and materials, dealing with TRL 7. They can be either public or private. This can be an RTO, for example, that is the anchor point for in one ecosystem. But we know public and private infrastructures that can also compete, and this is also your view, for that. If they satisfy the criteria before, everybody can answer, can be part of a proposal. When we say typically run by an RTO, it's because RTOs today are really dealing with this level of TRL. So it's an example, only an example. In which domain? So this is in line with the topics. So no surprise, but again, the objective is to create an ecosystem. So we will have 20 test beds, but they have, you will see in the next elements, they will have to initialize during their life, and mentioned in the proposal, how they will collaborate, if this is the case, if this is needed, with other test beds. Not only with the one dealing with multifunctional materials and components, for example, but also with the one dealing with nano-enabled surfaces and membrane, for example. So it's really important that they force it to have external interfaces, if I can say. What we can find, it's really what's related to testing, validation. So we have demonstration. But Next point is more important. So okay, you have the detail of all the activities. This was a point of discussion with the Commission. Funding of services is eligible. At the beginning, this was not the case. Said, okay, if there are already services, we will fund only the demonstrations. No. It's a new type of service that is going really beyond what they can do today, what is their role, their mission. So please fund also the services dealing with access to funding and so on and so on. What is not eligible, for sure, as infrastructure, acquisition, if not used, is not eligible. What is also already funded by any other source of budget. The added value, it's they have to provide answers regarding how they will satisfy this criteria, how they will organize their consortium to be a single entry point. It's very, very important. So one guy knocks to the door of an RTO, for example, and he says, this is my problem, this is my challenges. Okay, how can you solve my challenges? What is the benefit? What is the result? And the consortium will have an answer, and if the technology is in another place than the, where is the entry point, where the guy knocked, the consortium will have to organize the appropriate answer to the challenge. So single entry point, so really a logical bubble that will represent the different the implementation of the network. Another point is to address the value chain. So really consider the value chain, the business point of view. This is really a recommendation for the proposers. Single entry point, for sure, they have to show that how they will transfer technologies, accelerate the maturity of the final product for the customer, how they participate to reduce the overall cost, and also how they will have an impact on the procedures and testing at the end. You will have a slide. I think it's not my point today to have a discussion about each bullet, each word, but this is important for you, that now you know that this is existing. You can use it when you have to provide support to your clients. And so this is also, so we have to continue. There is two or three slides again. They have to present a market analysis, a business plan, which type of action they will develop. This is key also. What is missing in this version is, for example, when the DigiConnect is applying cascade funding in the different demonstrations, experimentations, in this case, for DGRTD, this will not be a solution, the cascade funding. So one actor will have to be the bank of the project, because they don't have visibility today on the level of experiments, the level of clients they will have to satisfy for the duration of the project. So one has to show the capability to be the bank for the consortium, and after to manage the financial workflow between the partners according to the actions they have to develop. So it's a consortium today. Any type of actor. For us, there is no recommendation in the number of participants. Someone today are say answering, hey Guy, you have to propose a consortium with 40 partners. This is not a criteria that will be as it is mentioned. Okay. I think more than the number of participants directly involved in the project, it's the ability to the partners to address a large set of factors, industrials, SMEs, other actors from research, that will make the difference. But this is a demonstration to be made, just to be sure that the guy, the expert, the evaluator, gets the point that, okay, this is credible, we don't need 40 actors, because it would be a mess to manage. It would be consume a lot of budget. But they have to develop the rationale. Open access, this is a constraint today, but it's not open access for free. So all has a value, and this shall be part of the business model. For who is concerned or has information about the business model of Kik, for example, we are close to this type of instrument. So have a look to what Kik are doing, and you will have an idea of what could be a good proposal for testbed. So as I said, single entry point, so it's to have an access. So I don't need to detail, I think, we will have to read. Yes, it's not only the partners that will benefit from the project, from the developments, but any type of action, any type of partner can be addressed, can benefit. It's clear, it's obvious, but it was good to mention. So you have, the proposers have to define, to present how they will offer an access, how this will be managed, in terms of coordination of activities, etc., separation of demonstrations in the proposal. This was a remark at the beginning. They have to present how they will plan to interact with other actions. I think not only regarding the testbed of DigiRTD, but also with the innovation hubs of DigiConnect. And I think it's obvious with the DigiGrow, because I think most candidates will come from the list of 200 actors already identified by DigiGrow. So this type of coordination, of cooperation, with the benefit to get from ideas or technologies from the robotic field or from the CPS side is very interesting regarding our concern today. It's only an idea, but they have to present how they will organize their cooperation. Yes, this will be a point that will be part of the evaluation. When we have to deal with sustainability, and mainly after the end of the project, it's clear that there is a demonstration to be made that a synergy with regional funding will exist or already exists. So this is a key concern regarding the sustainability of the infrastructure. Well, this is the difference they see regarding what is a digital innovation hub, what is a testbed. If I can make it short, it's in terms of tool, it's the same thing. We speak about ecosystem, European network, upscaling, and so on. The technology fields are not the same. The main difference is that testbed will not offer cascade funding. Because from the Commission point of view, cascade funding is somewhere there is a distortion in the principle, in the philosophy. If people know that there is they can get funding, funds, they automatically come. Here it's not the case. The budget is for the testbed, the actors of the testbed, and the result for the clients will be the technology, the transfer of knowledge and services. Yeah, so we have already introduced this point. Okay. One point is also that InnoSUP is already running. So it's separate entities. InnoSUP is mainly managing the network point of view, not really the transfer point of view. So it's a differentiation. And the KIC, I think interfaces with KIC could be possible for us with raw material, for example. But I think they have to present an interface with these communities to be developed according to the roadmap of the KIC and the needs they get from their ecosystem, from the testbed point of view. In the strategy of the European Commission, mainly for FP9, the research infrastructures will also be part of networks. So they are looking to which type of service collaboration they can establish with the research infrastructures. So this can be case by case to have access to a service for a specific product. But this is to be mentioned if there is an interest. This is the end of my presentation at the moment, so feel free to have questions or remarks, good or bad, you can. Thank you.
Okay, we had a couple of questions for you, but I think given the time now, it's best to leave the floor to your question. And we have a first question, Didier, from Najat Hadri, which is diseases diagnosis testbed eligible?
Again, sorry.
Diagnosis for diseases testbed.
Just for me to have... We'll read the question. I think for this type of testbed, I don't have a clear answer now. It's the limit of, I am a specialist of this domain, so I have difficulties. I can have a look. You can write to me directly. I think you have my email somewhere, and I will answer, I will check, analyze directly. Sorry, to not be able to answer to this specific point.
Okay, so we have another question by Thomas Sergoy. Can you give, as an example, to your opinion, how a consortium for a DIH proposal could look like? How many partners, which organization types, and how can the regional coverage look like?
We can imagine, or I could imagine, a consortium with four RTOs in key countries, I can say. Let's say, as an example, okay, UK, France, Germany, and Sweden, for example, or no, Finland. They have an access to clusters in their regions. So through the clusters, they get access to SMEs. So I would see a consortium with an RTO and a representative of a cluster. And with also satellites, as a competence center in a EU-certain country, for example, and with the same model, an entry point as a infrastructure of research and innovation, and one entity, one company managing the services. So more or less between 15 and 20 partners as a core set of partners with this type of profile. It's how I see the typical model.
Okay, well, we're already over time and I don't see any further questions from your side. Probably the question will come after maybe and we can continue this discussion. Just in terms of how you will get the presentation, what I will do this afternoon is I will send you a satisfaction questionnaire to make sure that the webinar answered your needs and also to make sure that we can improve future training sessions. And at the end of this questionnaire, you will have the link to retrieve the presentation. So I would really, really warmly thank Didier for his expertise on this subject. And thank you all for attending today. And I hope this will improve your activities as NCPs. And Didier just tells me they can contact me. So please contact Didier if you have further questions. I will make sure that you also get his email address to do so. So thank you very much and have a nice lunch break. Bye-bye.